Let's start with the classification of the antiarrhythmic drugs. So antiarrhythmic drugs are classified into four classes, that is class 1, and there are three subclasses there under, that is class 1A, class 1B and class 1C. The examples of class 1A, that is disopyramide, procainamide and quinidine. Class 1B examples are lidocaine and mexiletine. Class 1C, the examples are propafenone and flecainide. Then we have class 2 drugs. The examples are atenolol, metoprolol, and ismolol. As you can see, the suffix is LOL. So they belong to the class, that is beta blockers. Class 3 consists of sotalol, amiodarone, then dofetilide, dronedarone, and the ibutilide. Class 4, that is diltiazem and verapamil. And we have other drugs. Examples are adenosine, digoxin, magnesium sulfate, and ranolazine. Okay. So next, we are going to start with the class 1 drugs. Okay. So class 1 antiarrhythmic drugs, what is their mechanism of action? They act by blocking the voltage-sensitive sodium channels. Okay. So they have selectivity towards which type of or which stages of sodium channels they will bind to. They bind to the open and inactivated sodium channels. Okay. So they won't bind to the channels which are fully repolarized. Okay. So therefore, these drugs, they show greater degree of blockade in tissues that are frequently depolarized. Okay, so this property is called as use dependence. Means it depends on the state of the channel. And it enables this drug to block the cells that are discharging at abnormally high frequency. At abnormally high frequency without interfering with the normal beating of the heart. So that's why these drugs, they have more propensity to bind to the channels which are depolarizing with a higher frequency, that is the ectopic foci, rather than the normal cells. Okay. So class 1A antiarrhythmic drugs, let's see their mechanism of action. The quinidine, it binds to open and inactivated sodium channels, and thus it prevents sodium influx and thus slowing the rapid upstroke during the phase 0. So you can see the stiffness of the curve, it is also reduced. Okay. So it decreases slope of phase 4 and spontaneous depolarization, and inhibits potassium channels and blocks the calcium channels. Okay, so multiple of effects it has. That is, it is decreasing the slope of this phase 4, and thereby it decreases spontaneous depolarization. So because of all of these action, it slows conduction velocity and thus increases the refractoriness. Okay. So therapeutic uses of these drugs, effective in treatment of wide variety of arrhythmias, including atrial, atrioventricular junctional and ventricular tachyarrhythmias. It is used rarely due to its adverse effects. So the procainamide, it is only available in an intravenous formulation and may be used to treat the acute atrial and ventricular arrhythmias. Okay. So disopyramide, it is used in vagally mediated atrial fibrillation and in hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. So it can be used as an alternative treatment of ventricular arrhythmias. So pharmacokinetics, the quinidine sulfate or gluconate rapidly and well absorbed after oral administration. It undergoes extensive metabolism primarily by hepatic cytosolic P450 system 3A4, that is CYP3A4 isoenzyme, which is forming active metabolites. So it is the most common type of enzyme which causes metabolism of most of the drugs. A portion of procainamide, it is acetylated, so it is phase 2 reaction to N-acetyl procainamide, that is NAPA, which has properties and adverse effects of the class 3 drug. Okay, so this NAPA is eliminated via kidney. Therefore, dosage of procainamide should be adjusted in patient with renal dysfunction. Disopyramide is well absorbed after oral administration and is metabolized in liver by CYP3A4 to a less active metabolite and several inactive metabolites. About half of the drug is excreted unchanged by the kidneys. Okay, so the enzyme that is causing the metabolism is the same, that is CYP3A4 in both of the cases, that is disopyramide and the procainamide. But the difference is that when procainamide undergoes the metabolism, it forms the active metabolite. And in case of disopyramide, it forms the active metabolite, but it is less active as compared to the metabolite which is formed after metabolism of procainamide. And also, it disopyramide when undergoes metabolism in presence of CYP3A4, it also leads to formation of several inactive metabolites. Okay, so the adverse effects of which is associated with class 1A drugs, though these effects are effective to treat atrial fibrillation, but due to enhanced proarrhythmic effects and ability to worsen heart failure symptoms, they should not be used in patient with atherosclerotic heart disease or the systolic heart failure. So in these two conditions, these drugs, class 1A drugs, they are contraindicated. Large doses of quinidine may induce symptoms of the synchronism. So how it causes synchronism? Because it is obtained from the bark of cinchona tree. So it has a narrow therapeutic index. So that's why it causes the toxicity. So examples, so how to identify synchronism? It is blurred vision, tinnitus is a ringing sound in the ear, then headache is there, disorientation, and lastly the psychosis. So the drug interaction, they are common with quinidine because it is inhibitor of both, that is CYP2D6 and the P glycoprotein. Okay, so these are the major ways by which any drug can interact with the another drug, by inhibiting an enzyme that is responsible for the metabolism. So the intravenous administration of procainamide may cause hypotension and it can cause drug-induced lupus erythematosus. Okay, so disopyramide has a most anticholinergic adverse effects of class 1A drugs. So examples of this anticholinergic effect, that is dry mouth, urinary retention, blurred vision, and constipation. Both quinidine and disopyramide should be used with caution with potent inhibitors of the CYP3A4. Otherwise, drug-drug interaction will take place. So we have second category of drugs, that is class 1B antiarrhythmic drugs. So similar to that of the 1A, these are also causing the blockade of the sodium channels, but it has different effects onto the cardiac action potential. So this class 1B agent, they rapidly associate and dissociate from the sodium channels. So the actions are greater when the cardiac cells is depolarized or firing rapidly. So more specificity towards the cells of the ectopic foci. So in addition to the sodium channel blockade, the lidocaine and the mexiletin, they shorten phase 3 repolarization. You can see the phase 3. This is 0, this is 1, this is 2, and this is third phase. So there is shortening. You can see over here, this is normal action potential. it takes more time for the repolarization. But in case when we give the these drugs, that is type 1B sodium channel blockers, they reduce the time for the repolarization of the cardiac muscle action potential, cardiac muscles. Okay. Also, they decrease the duration of the action potential. Okay. So this effective refractory period, it is reduced. So therapeutic uses, although amiodarone is a drug of choice for ventricular fibrillation and the ventricular tachycardia, intravenous lidocaine may be used as an alternate. Okay. So lidocaine may also be used in combination with the amiodarone for the VT storm. VT is ventricular tachycardia storm. Okay. So the drug does not markedly slow conduction and thus has little effect on atrial or AV junction arrhythmias. Okay. So this is the difference between the type 1A and type 1B. So mexiletine is used orally for chronic treatment of ventricular tract arrhythmias, often in combination with the amiodarone. Okay. So pharmacokinetics, lidocaine given intravenously because extensive first pass transformation by the liver. Okay. So the drug is dealkylated to two active metabolites, primarily by CYP1A2 with minor role by the CYP3A4. Okay. So the major effect or major metabolism will be carried out by the enzyme, that is CYP1A2, and the minor portion of the drug will be metabolized by the CYP3A4. Lidocaine should be monitored closely when given in combination with drugs affecting these CYP isoenzymes. Mexiletine is well absorbed after oral administration. It is metabolized in the liver primarily by CYP2D6 to inactive metabolites and excreted mainly via the biliary route. Okay. So adverse effects, the lidocaine has fairly wide therapeutic index, so adverse effects are also less. Central nervous system effects, they include nystagmus, that which is an early indicator of toxicity, then drowsiness, slurred speech, then paresthesia, then agitation, confusion, and convulsions, which often limit the duration of continuous infusion. The mexiletine, it has narrow therapeutic index, and caution should be used when administering the drug, which are the inhibitors of the CYP2D6. Okay, so if given with the inhibitors of CYP2D6, there will be accumulation of mexiletine in the body due to reduction in its metabolism, and thus it will cause the toxicity. So that nausea, vomiting, and dyspepsia, they are the most common adverse effect associated with these drugs. Okay, we have the third category of drugs, that is class 1C antiarrhythmic drugs. So what these drugs do? These drugs slowly dissociate from the resting sodium channels and show prominent effects even at normal heart rates. So understand, the rate of dissociation is different from the sodium channels of the all of the three classes of the class 1 antiarrhythmic drugs. So the flecainide, it suppresses the phase 0 upstroke in Purkinje and the myocardial fibers. So this leads to the marked slowing of the conduction in all cardiac tissue with minor effect on duration of the action potential and a refractoriness. Okay, so automaticity is reduced by increase in threshold potential rather than decrease in slope of phase 4 depolarization. Okay, so the abnormality of automaticity, it is being resolved with the use of the class 1C drug. What it do? It reduces this automaticity by means of increasing threshold potential. So this is the mechanism by which it reduces the automatization. Other drugs, they reduce the slope of phase four depolarization, like the class 1A antiarrhythmic drugs. The flaconide, it also blocks the potassium channels and thus leads to increased duration of action potential. Okay, so the propafenone, like flaconide, it slows the conduction in all cardiac tissue, but does not, this is important, does not block the potassium channel. And also, this propafenone, it possesses weak beta blocking properties. So partially it shows effect like that of the class 2 antiarrhythmic drugs. Okay, so in this diagram you can see class 1C drugs, they markedly slow phase 0 depolarization. So instead of this it is stiffness of this class phase 0, there is less stiffness is achieved with these drugs. Okay, so therapeutic uses of class 1C, it's commonly used to maintain sinus rhythm in atrial fibrillation patient. So usefully in maintenance of sinus rhythm in atrial flutter or fibrillation in patients without structural heart disease and in treating refractory ventricular arrhythmias. Okay, so these agents must be used in combination with the AV blocking agents in order to prevent rapid atrial fibrillation and atrial flutter conduction. That is 1:1 conduction through the AV node, which results in very fast ventricular rates if breakthrough episode occurs, since class 1C drugs also act to increase AV nodal conduction. Okay. So this, if not used with the AV blocking agents, then these drugs are known to cause the arrhythmias. Okay, so they are pro-rhythmic drugs. Okay, which instead of preventing arrhythmia, they will culminate into the arrhythmias if not used with AV blocking agents. Flaconide is used as needed basis in outpatient setting. Okay, so its use is need based. It is not a must drug, it is use is need based. So use of propafenone is restricted mostly to the atrial arrhythmias, rhythm control of the atrial fibrillation or flutter, and paroxysmal supraventricular tachycardia prophylaxis in patients with AV reentrant tachycardias. Okay, so pharmacokinetics, flaconide is well absorbed after oral administration and is metabolized by CYP2D6 to multiple metabolites. The parent drug and metabolites are mostly eliminated renal. Propafenone is metabolized to active metabolite primarily via CYP2D6 and also by CYP1A2 and CYP3A4. The metabolites are excreted in urine and the feces. Adverse effects: the flaconide, it is well tolerated with blurred vision, dizziness, and nausea, which occurs more frequently. Then propafenone has the similar side effect profile and but may cause bronchospasm and should be avoided in patients with asthma. The propafenone is also inhibitor of P-glycoprotein. Both of these drugs should be used with caution with potent inhibitors of CYP2D6. Okay, so all of the next drugs, that is from class 2 onwards, we will be studying in next lecture. Okay, so with this, I will stop sharing. Okay, and I will also stop recording. Thank you.